News we're following here that this incident in Wakeley in Sydney Southwest is now being called an act of terror. In the last few moments, the New South Wales Premier Chris Minns and Police Commissioner Karen Webb making the declaration following last night's abhorrent attack inside a church in Wakeley near Fairfield. Look, we're about to show you the incident, but we must warn you, this footage is confronting. So at a press conference just moments ago, authorities confirmed a new strike force has been set up looking into the alleged attack, an incident they say was religiously motivated extremism. In total, 30 people were treated, including the bishop and a priest in that horrific video. Two officers and other parishioners were also injured in the aftermath. A police commissioner, Karen Webb.
At 1:35 a.m. this morning, after consideration of all the material, I declared that it was a terrorist incident. Strike Force Katrina has been established to investigate that side of the events last night, and a referral has been made and agreed to by the Joint Counterterrorism Investigation Team that we will work jointly with New South Wales Police lead with AFP and other Commonwealth agencies in this investigation.
So effectively, two different strands to this investigation. First of all, that attack in which they're now investigating as a terrorism act. And then the second part of that, the riots that happened. And the commissioner pointed out that those who took part in those riots and turned on police so that emergency services, including paramedics, had to hide inside that church for 3.5 hours under police protection. Those police fearing for their lives, as well as paramedics, while this riot took place outside. The commissioner saying that those people involved in those riots, well, they can expect a knock on the door if they were involved. And this comes following confirmation 20 police cars were damaged, 10 of them written off. The Premier was also there. You could see that he was pretty angry about the whole situation and pretty disturbed. Let's hear from him now.
This is a major and serious criminal investigation. It is crucial that New South Wales Police are able to devote their resources and intelligence, as well as officers, to the investigation of this crime. I want to make something very, very clear. There is no such thing in Australia in taking the law into your own hands. It doesn't exist. That's for several reasons. Firstly, you'll be met by the full force of the law if there's any attempt for tit-for-tat violence in Sydney over the coming days. Secondly, you are diverting police equipment, investigation power, as well as resources away from the investigation of this crime. And lastly, and perhaps most importantly, every religious leader representing communities across Western Sydney has expressly said, don't do it, and implored the community to come together to express faith and hope in the New South Wales Police and ensure that we remain united during these difficult days.
Look, he's pretty livid, isn't he, the Premier, and also disturbed about what's gone on. He's also very cognizant of the fact that there is serious tension in Western Sydney as we go to air and as this city confronts another devastating event. He likened the situation in Western Sydney between various groups as being, quote, combustible, as at a time when religious leaders, political leaders are all trying to come together to take the temperature out. Let's go back to Sarah now. Sarah?
Yeah, thanks, Carl. Quite a bit to get through, isn't there? I mean, it's not every day you hear about a terrorist act being declared by the police commissioner. In New South Wales, this is exactly what's just happened. I'm joined now, of course, by Independent MP member for Fowler, Di Lee. Di, what do you make of that announcement?
Look, I'm shocked. Basically, I think it's such a quick announcement. I don't know if they had time to really assess the situation. I understand probably the crowd, the gathering last night and the injuries of the police. I don't know if the declaration will help or hinder our community. And
what
I'm concerned.
What makes you say that? What are your concerns around that?
My concern is obviously, concern is in terms of our multi-faith communities here. And that will heighten the tension that obviously we are for months now experiencing overseas, and this is just an, it's just going to add to it. Mm-hmm. So I fear, and I hope that the Premier and that the Police Commissioner know what they're doing. They really know what they're doing when they're declaring this. And I hope that this will allow them to investigate the incident as quickly as possible and find, conclude the investigation to give us peace and maintain the cohesion that we have here in this wonderful multicultural community of ours. This has never happened. And so I think that it's as you mentioned, an incident like this to be declared as such is really quite concerning for me.
The Police Commissioner, New South Wales Police Commissioner Webb, does believe that this is likely to be an isolated incident, but that cohesion that you speak about, I mean, it was torn apart yesterday at 7 p.m. when that alleged stabbing happened in that church, a place where people should feel safe, where parishioners were gathering on a live-streamed event.
Yep.
And so they very quickly after that incident at 1:30 then declared this a terrorist act. And what followed then were multi-faith leaders coming together and meeting. So the idea, of course, is to try and address this as quickly as possible to de-escalate the situation.
I don't know if declaring a terror event will de-escalate or escalate. So I will...
You think they've come to that conclusion too quickly?
I feel that declaring anything as a terror event in a small community, and we are in a residential place, by the way, what message that will send to the rest of our community? I can guarantee you it will not send out a message of peace. It will not send out a message of safety in particular, because as I said, we are in a residential place after all. So I love it how our leaders, who are actually not from our community, can come to this conclusion. And I don't know which leaders they have got, their religious leaders, whether were they from our community, I've got no idea. And in situation like this, it's just think about it, put themselves in our shoes. How would you feel now living in this street around here if they will feel safe?
I mean, some significant concerns you raised there.
Absolutely. I am concerned. And like I said, I hope that the police will act and get to the bottom of this as soon as possible, because this will, to get to the bottom of and finding the issues will create more safety in our community rather than just the terror act.
We know, of course, the church has released a statement. They were urging urging peace and calm yesterday following what happened.
Yep.
That took a while to dissipate. Obviously, those crowds yesterday, everyone heightened emotions, as we know. The Premier has come out again, as well as the Commissioner, urging calm, peace in the community. Do you think people will listen?
Well, you know, I think you're quite aware that the word terror act will take precedent over calm and, calm anytime. That's how our brain is wired. So I will see, I hope that they will see what their words, because language is very important. Language is so important, and I think why they chose that language, I hope they have a very good reason, and I heard the Commissioner said that they will, they put that legislation in, but they can also take it off as soon as possible once they get to the bottom of this. And I hope that they do it as quickly as possible, because I want to ensure that our community feels safe.
Yep.
Because I can guarantee you, declaring it as a terror event will not make people safe.
I think safety is certainly the number one priority for everyone involved here. And we know that extra police resources will be deployed to the area to ensure that safety. Carl, major breaking news, as you know, and as we'll be following from here.
Look, I can understand the complexities of what Di's dealing with out there today. However, that being said, there is no way to sugarcoat an act like this. And police, according to their own laws, this particular act has to meet a threshold, and according to police, it met it. What everyone at home is not privy to is some of the conversation that was had between this 15, 16-year-old and the bishop. I'm sure that it will come out. I'm not sure when, but that will come out. Whatever he has said in the process of committing that act, fact, has met the threshold for a terrorism event. So there's no way of sugarcoating some of this. As much as you want peaceful language and as much as you want the temperature to be taken out, there is unfortunately a legal reality here, and police believe it's met that threshold. Look, we'll go back to that area in a second, but we've also heard from the Prime Minister, Anthony Albanese. He's made a statement just a short time ago. This is what he's had to say. I have been briefed by the AFP and our security agencies regarding the shocking incident at Wakeley's Christ the Good Shepherd Church. As police continue their investigations, Australians are thinking of those who have been injured, the first responders who rushed to help, and the police who worked to restore order. In testing times, Australians stand together. We will need to stand together on this one as well. Goes on, doesn't it? Well, Lara Vella is in Wakeley, where the riot took place. This is the second part of perhaps what Di was talking about in terms of just easing those tensions. Lots of pressure in that area. Lots of pressure came after this alleged terror incident. So, Lara, what is it like on the streets?
Carl, good morning to you. Yeah, just touching on that, we've had quite a few residents, you know, driving up to us this morning saying not only are they frightened by what took place last night, they are absolutely frustrated by the actions of thousands of people outside this church. We had one gentleman in particular, Carl, just to pick up upon a point you were making earlier. He was also trying to give us some of the background in terms of some of the things that this teenager is alleged to have said inside the church. Regardless, though, we now know that two separate strike forces have been set up in relation to this, the first one being as a result of what has now been deemed an act of terror. The second one, though, in relation to those actions that we saw from those thousands of people last night. Strong words this morning, Carl, from both the New South Wales Premier, Chris Minns, alongside the New South Wales Police Commissioner, Karen Webb, condemning this so-called vigilante approach. It appeared that last night some of the crowd did try and take matters into their own hands, and we know that some of the tensions really kicked off when that alleged offender still remained inside that church. He was under police guard. We know that from some of the footage now and some of the reports coming from the ground that those among the crowd were trying to use a ladder to break in. It is then that they have become frustrated and they've directed those frustrations straight towards police officers. As we heard during that press conference, as a result of that, the police officers who were deployed to that church to protect those people, well, they then felt that they were themselves coming under attack. So we heard that officers alongside paramedics remained holed up inside that church for at least 3 hours. That is how hot the situation was on the outside. And you can see this morning where we are, Carl, we're still around 150 metres to 200 metres from where the church is. There is so much glass and debris scattered right across these residential areas because we now know as the crowd started to disperse, they were grabbing everything that they could get their hands on, including bricks that we've seen literally pulled from fences here and using them to smash some of the windscreens. We now know confirmation from the police commissioner that at least 20 police cars were damaged. 10 in total were completely written off. That gives you an indication of just how significant the damage was. So as I say, really strong words from both the Premier and the Police Commissioner calling for calm and strongly condemning the actions of every person that was here last night. And she specifically said that those that they can identify, they will be arrested and they will also be prosecuted too, Carl.
All right, Lara, thank you. Also mentioned during that press conference was the fact that there are multiple injuries, including, you know, the crowd, the police officers, and the bishop and the priest. Let's try and glean some more information on how that's going, that side of things, with Jack Harner, who joins us at Liverpool Hospital, a place that was locked down last night given the intensity of emotion. Jack, the two men injured from the church, how are they recovering?
Yeah, locked down for several hours. In fact, the situation warranted a response from police that blocked off the road, and the only people allowed in were people in the back of ambulances or people with life-threatening injuries. I can tell you that the two victims inside the church, the bishop and that hero bystander that raced in to perform a citizen's arrest, they were taken here to Liverpool Hospital, given that it is the closest trauma hospital, about 8 kilometres away from the scene. This morning, they are undergoing emergency surgery. Given that this is a trauma hospital, there are operating rooms always on standby. Trauma surgeons here 24/7, and this morning they are working around the clock to try and stabilize these two people's injuries. We know that the bishop is suffering some very serious injuries. The Premier said it himself. He said, make no mistake, that he is suffering some serious injuries. We are told from the hospital that both are doing okay. They are not necessarily life-threatening injuries, and they are listed as being in stable conditions. But of course, there are inherent risks when you go into surgery that these two patients are facing this morning. Now, as for the police officers were injured in this as well. I can tell you that they've been taken to various hospitals, one taken to a Westmead hospital, in fact, for non-life-threatening injuries as well, but for a broken jaw and for a twisted knee, very painful injuries, as you could imagine. And Spera thought that these patients had to wait 3.5 hours with paramedics by their side before they could be even transported to hospital. We heard that from the New South Wales Ambulance Commissioner. 6 paramedics had to retreat in the church with the patients. So that means for 3.5 hours, those paramedics could not go to their vans to get more medicine. They could not go to their vans to get more specialist equipment. And they could not go to their vans to simply transport these patients. It took that amount of time for police from right across this city to stabilise the situation. And it was a huge police response. We heard that the riot police, the Raptor squad, tactical police, and then general duties officers from right around this city, from the southwest, the northwest, the northern beaches, the city, everyone responded, and it still took 3.5 hours. Now, ambulance crews in total treated 30 patients, as you pointed out, Carl. 20 patients were treated for the use of pepper spray. Those were a mix of the people among the riots, but also emergency service workers. We've been hearing reports that even ambulance crews received some pepper spray amid the riot. So injuries associated with pepper spray include the obvious, that your eyes start tearing up, but some people even suffer breathing issues and irritations to the skin. Now, ambulance crews took a handful of patients to hospitals. Police took one patient to a hospital, and then another member of the public presented at an emergency department. We've also heard about the 15-year-old this morning. We are told that he is at an undisclosed hospital. We don't know what hospital that is, but we do know that it's not here at Liverpool. Police have been very keen to point that out, given that this hospital was locked down. He underwent surgery overnight for significant hand injuries. We do know that he suffered some very, very, very significant hand injuries, but he's said to be okay after the surgery last night at that undisclosed hospital. There is a very heavy police presence there. Right. He is under a police guard, but certainly a huge response from the emergency services, Carl.
That's for sure. A huge amount of detail there, Jack. Thank you for that. Look, there is some conjecture. There's plenty of, again, stuff on social media about what happened to this kid after the alleged attack. And we're not going to go into it. We'll wait for police, as the commissioner pointed out. There is still a fair bit of investigating to do there in relation to how he became injured himself. None of it's pretty. Let's just recap, too, in relation to him. A 15 or 16-year-old was known to police. The commissioner said he was not on a watch list, but known to police. There was a degree of premeditation in all of this, that being that he travelled a fair way from where he lives and he travelled with a knife. Now, he acted alone, they believe. It's possibly a flick knife. Police are working on that. And he is, as Jack pointed out, currently in surgery. A number of people are fortunate to have escaped with the injuries they have sustained and they're not being more serious.